Welcome to this Linklaters Pension Group podcast. I'm Michael Jones, and I'm here with my colleague, Rebecca Birdsall. Today, we're looking at the requirement for trustees and IGCs to assess whether their DC pension arrangement offers value for money to members.
New statutory governance standards came into effect from April 2015 for workplace DC pension schemes, which span both contract and trust-based schemes. The policy intention behind these requirements is to improve member outcomes at retirement and to ensure that individuals get better value for money from their pension arrangements. Trustees of DC occupational pension schemes must appoint a chair of trustees, who is required to report annually to members that the charges and transaction costs borne by members represent good value. The first chairman's statement is due 7 months from the end of the scheme year. If the scheme year ends before 5th of April 2016, the statement should cover the period from 6th of April 2015. Similarly, on the contract-based side, providers of personal pension schemes must establish independent governance committees, known as IGCs. IGCs are required to report annually on the ongoing value for money for policyholders by assessing whether the default funds and non-default investment strategies are designed in the interests of scheme members. IGCs must publish their first annual report by 6th of April next year.
The concept of value for money is a key issue arising from the new governance requirements. However, there is no statutory definition of either good value or value for money, and to date, neither the pensions regulator nor the FCA has provided a detailed framework for assessing value for money. The pensions regulator published its consultation on the draft DC code last week, but this addresses good value at a high level only, and further guidance is expected next year. Trustees and IGCs must adopt their own processes for providing their value for money assessment. The value for money thinking is more developed on the contract-based side, with the impending April 2016 deadline for publishing annual reports, so trustees can potentially draw useful parallels from the approach being adopted by IGCs to value for money.
The first point is that good value may not be the same for one scheme as it would for the other. No one size fits all. Good value does not necessarily need to mean low cost, provided that higher costs can be justified by improved benefits. For example, a well-run scheme may cost members more, but it would lead to better outcomes for members and be of good value. There's a wide variety of views in the industry as to what value for money means. The starting point is to assess the charges met by members. When looking at charges, trustees should assess the element of pension provision for which members bear the cost only, and not the costs of distinct services met by the employer. These costs should then be compared against the benefits and services the scheme provides, generally known as the quality of the scheme. These would include how the default strategy reflects the interests of scheme members, the range of investment options, the efficiency of administration and processes, overall fund performance, the quality of the support services for members, and scheme governance.
However, value for money goes further than simply a costs versus benefits comparison, and we're seeing a number of schemes looking at member outcomes, and in particular, members' investment returns, to see what they actually get from contributing to the scheme once scheme costs have been taken into account. The ultimate objective of a pension arrangement is to provide financial security in retirement, and so trustees and IGCs should look at whether the charges borne by the members are reasonable for the outcomes expected from the investment. Another theme of a value for money assessment is whether it should be retrospective or prospective. This is essentially whether an assessment should just look at whether members have had value for money to date, or whether members are likely to get value for money in the future. In our view, a value for money assessment should be primarily forward-looking, because the new governance requirements began in April 2015, with a view to making changes and reporting on the progress made to date. Trustees and IGCs should take the economic value of members' investments as at the 6th of April 2015 and consider whether the charges taken going forward are value for money. However, there needs to be an element of looking back, particularly if a scheme has a large number of deferred members in legacy arrangements with complex fixed fee structures.
It's easier in practice for trustees to address poor value legacy schemes than IGCs. Subject to complying with scheme rules, they can usually move deferred members' pots to new funds that offer better value for money. In contrast, IGCs have no ability to make changes to funds themselves, and so the extent to which IGCs are successful in asking providers to write off some or all of their legacy book fees will vary between providers and may depend on the extent to which providers can vary members' contractual arrangements. We expect that IGCs will work with their provider to put together an implementation plan for addressing legacy schemes that offer poor value for money. But a lot will depend on the willingness of the provider to make changes.
The draft DC code says that trustees should ensure that all members, including those in decumulation as the spend phase of retirement saving, should benefit from good governance. However, the FCA has suggested that IGCs do not need to include decumulation in their value for money assessment, and so it is unclear whether trustees and IGCs should include decumulation. We would expect trustees to consider including decumulation in any assessment, particularly where they have implemented the new DC flexibilities in their schemes, so drawdown is offered directly rather than via a transfer out. The way in which members take their benefits at retirement can make a big difference to their retirement income. We're seeing more schemes targeting drawdown at retirement as part of their default strategy, so ignoring the post-retirement landscape may run a risk of not providing a complete picture. We will monitor how practice develops in this area.
The pensions regulator says that trustees need to understand what members value most when assessing the overall value of their scheme. And investment governance is one of the most influential factors in delivering good outcomes. This means trustees and IGCs should look at the characteristics of members enrolled in the default and determine whether a particular service is likely to deliver value to them. For instance, there may be a high proportion of individuals who value the availability and use of ethical funds in the default. It's tricky for trustees and IGCs to decide to what extent they should take members' views into account. The draft DC code says trustees should engage with members about their preferences and financial needs, and use member feedback to set the investment strategies and provide investment options. However, members may attribute high value to things that, in reality, are not a key component of the true worth of their scheme membership, and low value to things that are. When combined with low member engagement and levels of feedback, trustees will need to decide how much weight to attribute to members' views. Again, this is a developing area where practice will differ between schemes, as there's no one size fits all.
The pensions regulator and FCA expect trustees and IGCs to benchmark their schemes against others in the market as a way of evaluating value for money. The FCA is looking for consistency of approach amongst IGCs, but wants them to be subjective and to avoid uniformity. This is clearly a difficult balancing act. We envisage that a comparison of relative value for members in different schemes is an area that will develop and be easier once chairs have provided their value for money assessment and consistent cross-market data on transaction costs is available. In any event, it is likely that trustees and IGCs would want a comparator and to see what price is available in the market for schemes of equivalent type offering an equivalent proposition. When comparing schemes, trustees in particular should bear in mind that two schemes can have the same arrangement with the same provider and the same fund range, but due to the size of the scheme and membership profile, one scheme has higher charges than the other. This does not mean that one scheme is good value and the other is not, but simply that one scheme is better value than the other. The draft DC code recommends that where there is limited member feedback, trustees should look at alternative methods such as publicly available industry research reports to compare to similar schemes in the market. We all want to see what the industry produces on this.
Due to the difficulties of making a value for money assessment across a provider's book of business as a whole, we would expect IGCs to segment their assessment across different categories of member, whether it be active or deferred, by members' ages, pot size or contribution levels. Segmentation is a useful tool for trustees too, particularly if there are clear divisions in the workforce between blue-collar and white-collar employees, or there is a high proportion of members in employment for a short period of time with small pots. For example, if a scheme's workforce has a large number of members who remain in the scheme for a short period of time, but the cost of setup are paid up front, this will not favour the majority of members.
A scheme may provide better value for members at different stages of their lives. A member in the early years of their pension will usually pay much less than someone who has been in the scheme for a long time with a large pot. Effectively, the long-stay member subsidises the new member for fixed-term costs, such as production of annual statements. The existence of this element of cross-subsidy is inevitable and should not raise concerns so long as each group of member receives value for money. In many ways, the future charges to a member could be considered to be subsidising some of the services they receive in the early years of their pension.
A final point for trustees and IGCs to consider in their value for money assessment is communications. The draft DC code highlights the quality of communications as a key factor in assessing value for members. Costs spent on communications which help members engage with their pension, increase their contributions, and plan for retirement will go a long way to improving the quality of the scheme and enable good member outcomes at retirement. As we have mentioned already, there will be more developments in this area, and we're monitoring how practice evolves for trustees and IGCs. Further updates will be provided next year.
And that concludes the podcast. Please get in touch with your usual Linklaters contact if you have any queries or would like to discuss. For other podcasts you might like, please visit linklaters.com or our pensions group page on LinkedIn. Thank you for listening.